Good morning and welcome to worship at Metropolitan Community Church of Richmond. I want to warn you, this team here today that is helping to make sure this broadcast happens, they are out of control. Now, I have said that several Sundays, but today they are absolutely out of control. So get ready, we're in for a good time. We want to welcome you and remind you to please send me an email this week from wherever you're watching this service. My email address is godguykenny@gmail.com. godguykenny@gmail.com. And that is godguykenny@gmail.com. And we invite you even now, as we begin our time of worship together, to begin greeting people in the comment section on the Facebook Live. Say hi to each other and welcome people to worship. And maybe you want to ask them too, did you get up this morning and brush your teeth? Have you combed your hair? Do you have on your pajamas? What's going on with you? Now, the thing about MCC Richmond people is they might tell you. So get ready for whatever response they might have. And we thank you for those responses so you'll join the environment of being out of control here in the sanctuary. Last week, we had people watch us from, such a great number, from Henrico, Verina, Richmond, Florida, New York, North Carolina, South Carolina, Oklahoma, New Mexico, Texas, California, West Virginia. Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. Give yourselves a hand. We thank you for being part of our growing virtual community as MCC Richmond continues to reach out to people with the message of God's amazing love for each and every one of us. Also, I want to thank you for sending me your parables this week, your personal parables. We had a record number of 26 people who sent parables to me either by email or through a text message. So thank you for that. I love the way that we are engaged with our God and our experience with our God. This week, you'll have another opportunity to share with me, and Sean will tell you what that's about during the announcements this morning. This week, the sanctuary has been extremely busy, but doing something that we have been working on for months around here. And so I've asked Kathy to take the camera up to the window above where Macon sits. You'll notice that there is no peeling paint, no cracked wood. Everything has been repaired and repainted. Thank you so much for your generosity to MCC Richmond. We have been able to have our 10 windows in the sanctuary, the stained glass windows, the wood casings have been completely painted, the peeling paint has been removed, they've been sanded, and they're in great shape. And we will continue now to see where else and what else we'll paint as we take care of our building that God has given us to use for God's service. So as we have this time of worship, we also invite you to get a small glass of juice or wine, a cracker or a piece of bread or a part of a donut so that you can participate with us in the sacred meal. And also please get a candle that we can light as we form our community together as we light our Christ candle. So now let's set the intention for our worship service by sharing together the words of Sharon Wiley. Sharon writes, "We speak so often of brokenness in religious life. Let us speak today of wholeness. You are welcome here. All of you, every part of you, beautiful just the way you are. Here you do not need to be something more or something less. No holding back, no hiding, no exerting yourself, no trying to do more or be more. You have inherent worth and dignity, nothing to prove here, nothing to prove to me or the person sitting next to you or to the children or to anyone. You don't have to try to be witty or more quiet or more outgoing. You are beautiful. Every part of you beautiful just the way you are. You do not need to change anything about yourself to be welcome here. Your skin, your hair, your belly, your limbs, your face, all beautiful just the way they are. You are extraordinary. Each and every one of you different from each and beautiful in your own special way. Breathtaking. Now let us worship the God who says you are welcomed and loved just the way you are.
Good morning. Okay, we're starting a new song today because Kenny asked for it. So blame it. You can blame on him, whatever happens here. So we are family. So get ready. And of course, I've changed some of the words around, so make sure you watch what Sean puts up here. So, okay. All right, Megan.
Come on, Tia. Let's put some boogie in here.
Good morning. I was so busy dancing. I was definitely in the spirit. And truly, we are family. And I welcome you here to our gathering today at MCC at Richmond. We are the family of God, our beloved community. And I welcome our new visitors who are sharing this time and this space with us for the first time. And welcome back those who have been with us before. I'm believing and praying that everyone has had an excellent week since we last spoke. Much is going on and much is happening in our lives individually as well as collectively. This week we put to rest Congressman John Lewis. Let's hold fast to all that his life represented, and that is the love of humanity. You know, he was a real pioneer for the LGBTQ community. He spoke a truth that we're all children of God. So we bring community here in three ways. First, by giving you our beloved greeting. Then we go into our Rua practice. And then we continue to with the lighting of the candle. And I don't use the word conclusion because we at MCC so that once the cameras stop, our ministry continues. So having said that, welcome, 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 beloved from all over the city, the nation, the world. I am just so happy to do this every Sunday to just know that we are connected spiritually and in spirit. So let us say our greetings together. Sean is holding the paper. He was anticipating. He said, hurry up and do this. This is great. But we do our greetings, and we do it in sincerity because who you are to us means a lot. And who you are in God means even more so. So together, let's say our greeting. It doesn't matter who you are, where you've been, or what you've done, how you love, or who you love, God welcomes you, and so do we. You are welcome here. And staying in that frame of welcomeness and openness, we go into our rule of practice. And we extend that welcome to the Holy Spirit. We extend our welcome to the breath of God that permeates us, that fill our lungs, our body, our vessel with the life force, but also renews and refreshes us, guides and directs us into all right action. So I would ask you at this time to take in a breath, a gentle breath, not forceful, not aggressively, but just a gentle breath, and feel that gentleness of the beloved, just filling our vessel, our body, illuminating us with its presence. And it doesn't stop there. It goes through us and out into our beloved community. Just sit with that for a second. Just feel it. Now release it, letting it go just as gentle as you did on the intake. Release it in love. Release it knowing that you and God are one. As our way shower, Jesus the Christ said, I and Abba are one. Therefore, we are one in good and in Christ. Now let's take in another breath. Just as gentle, but this time take in knowing the knowingness, the knowable, that you are one in and as and through God. That your good is at hand because Abba is at hand. You are blessed, and you are a blessing to us and to all that comes within your life circle. Because the Ruah, the breath, is in you, through you, and as you. Now release it. Release it in peace. Oh, release it knowing. Release it in confidence that you are loved. And you are being loved in so many ways, seen and unseen. And as we say, it doesn't matter who you are, God loves you. Infinity, infinite ways. And we rest with that. And we say, so it is. So it shall be. And now we enter into our time of lighting our candle. This is a twofold procedure. We light the external, symbolizing that we are lights to the world. And then we light our internal, symbolizing our oneness in Christ and God and the allness that there is. Light your candle. Let it shine. Not just for this service, not just for this day, but let it be part of you, of all that you are. Shine bright. Let that living spirit just flow from you. That all that comes within your circle see the light. And we give you all the thanks and all the praise. Amen.
Lord, I love to sing your praise. The call to worship, based on Psalm 145, 8 through 10, 13. The Lord is merciful and compassionate, very passionate and full of faithful love. The Lord is good to everyone and everything. God's compassion extends to all God's handiwork. All that you have made gives thanks to you, Lord. All your faithful ones bless you. Come, let us worship our God, whose faithfulness endures forever.
Good morning, church. Will you join me in prayer? Eternal God, we come before you today to praise you for your sustaining grace. We praise you for bringing us to this hour and for providing the oxygen we need for our next breath. We praise you for providing us a place to worship and to fellowship. We praise you for the leaders that inspire and create, to aid us in our connections with you. We praise you for being God, and we praise you that we are your creatures on this planet. We come to you today in need of your presence. We pray for our own personal peace, as well as for peace for our neighborhoods and our world. We pray for solidarity as we strive to recognize the value of every human being, every living organism. We pray for the bonding of all creation in love and respect. We pray for the delicate balance of water and air and breath that envelops the ecosystem. We pray for the oceans that cover much of our planet, the life and breath that fills the deep and sustains much of the world's food and water. Help us be mindful of every action we take that leaves a footprint on the face of this world. We pray for the multitudes who are experiencing suffering at this time. We pray for your intervention to bring us back to a place of security and peace. We pray for thoughtfulness and reasonableness to rule. And we pray for your love to dominate all of our actions and thoughts. We need your love, God, for ourselves and for our world. We need all of the good interventions of your Holy Spirit. Breathe on us and make us new again. We name those on our thoughts and minds at this moment. Mary Adams, Roger Blunk, Carol Anderson. We lift all breathing beings on this earth to you for protection and for love. We ask your presence in our hearts and minds. In all personal and cosmic names of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Time and prayed for me. I'm so glad they prayed. I'm so glad they prayed. I'm so glad they prayed for me. Somebody prayed for me. Had me on their mind. Took the time and prayed for me. I'm so glad they prayed.
Sacred text. Hear the sacred text from Matthew 14, 13 through 21. When Jesus heard about the beheading of John the Baptizer, he left Nazareth by boat and went to a deserted place to be alone. The crowds heard of this and followed him from their towns on foot. When Jesus disembarked and saw a vast throng, his heart was moved with pity, and he healed their sick.
As evening drew on, the disciples approached Jesus and said, "This is a deserted place, and it is already late. Dismiss the crowd so they can go to the villages and buy some food for themselves." Jesus said to them, "There is no need for them to disperse. Give them something to eat yourselves." "We have nothing here," they replied, "but 5 loaves and a couple of fish." "Bring them here," Jesus said. Then he ordered the crowds to sit on the grass. Taking the 5 loaves and 2 fish, Jesus looked up to heaven, blessed the food, broke it, and gave it to the disciples, who in turn gave it to the people.
All those present ate their fill. The fragments remaining, when gathered up, filled 12 baskets. About 5,000 families were fed.
May the Lord add a blessing to these words.
I believe kids ought to stay kids as long as they can. Turn off the screen and love the tree, get dirt on their hands. I believe we gotta forgive and make amends. Cause nobody gives a second chance to make no more friends. I believe in
today that most people are good? I believe that all people are good because that's the way that God created them to be. And when we step into that goodness of being, we experience more than we ever imagined was out there for us to experience. And this morning, I have been moved by George's words of confidence and the reminder of John Lewis, Congressman John Lewis, who encouraged the world because he had breath. He said, until he does not have breath, every breath in his body, he will find a way to get into some trouble. And what kind of trouble did he want to get into? Good trouble. And he wanted to get into good trouble, not simply for the matter of raising hell, but he wanted to get into good trouble to fight for those who were oppressed, to fight for those who had need, to fight for those who, in one way or another, were marginalized, because there is so much good to give and to experience in our person and living here in the United States. But more importantly, there's so much good to experience in God's kingdom. And that's exactly what we learned this morning. And Philip reminded us to focus on thoughtfulness, whatever is thoughtful and whatever is reasonable. And as I reviewed this sacred text this week, Sean can tell you, I would go into the office and I would say to Sean, well, what do you think about this? And what do you think about that? And what do you think about this? And then Sean had to, as he does every week, had to be with me as he recorded the two videos, my voluntold assignments, don't you know, as we recorded those videos. And Sean said, oh, I see you got it. But what we got is the question, first of all, to answer, why this sacred text? This is the only sacred text that is written in every single one of the Gospels. So why this story? What is so important about it? And what does it reveal to us about who God is and who God wants to be in our lives? What does it reveal to us about Jesus and Jesus's priorities? And what does it say who we as the people of God are called to be and are called to do? I imagine, just like when I think to myself, oh, this is a good idea, I imagine that the gospel writers said, this is a story that is definitely worth remembering. And so each one of the communities that were living in the day that the gospels were written found a way to include this in the story. And while it's a story about the feeding of the 5,000, and that's a wonderful miracle, but while that is something that we cannot ever forget, what is it about this story that we see the overarching scene? Jesus has heard the news that his friend John the Baptizer has been beheaded for telling the truth. John hadn't done anything criminal. John just told the truth. So Jesus needed to get away. And I love that image of Jesus, who was moved, he was saddened, and he needed to spend some time away from people. And so what does he do? He gets in a boat to go spend some time with Abba God. And then when Jesus comes back, what is he faced with? In the midst of his grief, in his midst of dealing with unbelievable sadness, Jesus looks up and he sees the crowd. In the sacred text, in this translation, it says that Jesus was moved with pity. In other translations, it uses the word compassion. Jesus had compassion. And the Greek word, here we go for all you Bible nerds like me. Oh, isn't that interesting? Georgia, Philip, and Tia's head just popped up. I love that. The Greek word that's used for compassion or pity here means he was moved from within his gut. So Jesus felt compassion that was very real. Jesus saw the need of the crowd And Jesus embraced the crowd and met their need. Now the disciples realize, oh, it's too late. Send them on their way. And Jesus said, no, no. Because Jesus had compassion for the crowd. He knew it was important to meet their need, each and every one of their needs. And yet, as we think about this sacred text, while this miracle is so important and wonderful, incredible, all those adjectives of goodness, I think it's also important not to miss the other miracles that are also within this story, because it's not simply what Jesus does that's so important, but why Jesus does them. The character of God that Jesus reveals and shares with the crowd is motivated and captured in one single word. It's that word, compassion. Jesus saw the crowd's need. He healed their sick. He took care of each and every one of their needs. He shared with them and spent time with them. And when evening came and he discovered that they did not have enough food, what did Jesus do? Jesus blessed the food and made sure that the crowd had enough. Jesus sees the crowd, really sees the crowd, and has compassion for their predicament. The truth is, as we read this story, we expect Jesus to do that. We expect that Jesus is going to meet our needs. We sometimes expect that Jesus is going to meet our needs. But in Jesus' day, that is not what people expected of anyone who talked about God. The gods of Jesus' day were known as those who didn't have compassion, that were uncaring, that could have cared less about the struggle that humans go through. And so what we see is that Jesus is beginning to prove and show the people about God's amazing love, about God's concern for each and every one of them. And you know what? That concern continues to this day. God wants us to know how much God is concerned with the things that burden our hearts, the things that we're concerned with. God is concerned when we are feeling broken, that we remember that we are created for wholeness, that we are created for beauty, and there is beauty in the midst of brokenness. And often, God uses us just like Jesus used the disciples to bring those miracles. And so that's a miracle that we should not overlook, that even when the disciples couldn't believe, when the disciples were probably at the end of their rope, they were tired, they wanted the crowds to get away so they could spend time encouraging Jesus or whatever was on their mind. Jesus said, no, no, no. Let's meet the needs. Let's have compassion. Let's let people experience the transforming love of God. How many times do we find ourselves in that same position of being tired, of being overwhelmed ourselves, of having so much to deal with in life? And then when somebody comes up to us, or we see them coming, we're like, oh Lord, not this one again. This conversation's gonna take more than a simple hello, or have a good day. This person is gonna require that I listen. And don't you know, it's in the listening that sometimes the miracle happens. just in the conversation of being able to connect with an individual, of an individual that is really hurting. Perhaps they have just lost their job. Perhaps they've just gotten a diagnosis that they can't even imagine. Perhaps they've just spent their last bit of money. Perhaps they're fearing that they're not going to be able to pay their rent. Perhaps they're in a position of worrying about the stimulus check and that extra $600 from the unemployment benefit. But one thing for sure, when people come at you with a need, it's because they're hurting. And sometimes we can get so tired of hearing the needs that we just want to turn our backs. And I'm here to tell you that it's in those moments when you don't feel like you can hear one more issue that God breaks through your heart and begins to do something beautiful within you. And then the exchange happens and life is transformed. There's yet another miracle that God uses us, especially when we don't want to be used. Especially when we feel like we have no more energy to listen. Where we've been so overwhelmed, we're just tired. And then God comes through to remind us that it's all about love. And that just like Jesus blessed the 5 loaves and 2 fish, the little bit that the disciples had, once Jesus blessed that, gave them to God, and waited to see the impossible happen. From 5 loaves and 2 fish, 5,000 people were fed to an abundance. And don't you know, those disciples got to serve that food. Jesus said to the disciples, bring what you have. Jesus blessed it. And then the disciples found themselves caught up with the joy of knowing that from disbelief came miracle beyond miracle. And they were used to help the miracle happen. Whatever their disbelief, I'm sure the disciples were filled with overwhelming joy as they witnessed the blessing of God as they fed people, and just not fed them a little. The sacred text says, fed them till they were all full. And then something wonderful happened, and it happens often in my house, and I'm so excited about this. After the feeding, there were 12 baskets of leftovers. Better leftovers than Kirk Blandford cooks. And you know that's good. 12 baskets. And what does that remind us of? The abundance of God. When we give what we have, there is always, always enough. And there's usually some left over so that we can be reminded and enjoy that. I think another miracle of this text is that we are reminded what happens when you move from a place of scarcity to abundance. When you give what you have to be used to bless others and give it to God, asking God to multiply it, what happens is that you realize that it's not just 5 loaves and 2 fish. It's just not $10 to put in the offering plate. It's not that you've run out of money, but it's waiting to see how God is going to multiply, how God is going to provide. It's how God is going to make an abundance for us to live within. Because here's the deal. You may indeed run out of money, but will you be willing to let God move in a way so that you can receive the blessing? Can you believe and can you not be so proud to ask for help? Woo! Now there we get into some meddling. Because sometimes we get so proud that we cannot reach out for help. And yet we at MCC Richmond have a plethora to be able to give, to help make a difference in one another's lives. And why do we give so abundantly here at MCC Richmond? Because we understand that God has called us to live a life of compassion, to give of what we have been given, and we make it our business to get into that good trouble to provide for those who are in need in any way. And the goodness is, it never runs out. It never runs out. Another miracle within this sacred text is that those same miracles happen today. They happen in our midst. I shared with you the miracle of peanut butter and tuna about a month ago, but I want to remind you of that today. At the Vicki Hester Food Pantry, we are seeing so many more people than what we ever imagined. About 3 years ago, I challenged the leadership of that ministry to not be open every other week, serving a handful of people. But I asked them to believe that God would provide what we needed so that we could be open every week. And you know what has happened since those days? Not only are we open every week, there is not a day that goes by within this COVID-19 reality that people haven't come to the church door asking for food, and it's always there. It is always there. There are days that we run out of peanut butter and tuna, and we have seen God worked in a way to where somebody walked in with a donation, and guess what they had? The only things they had in the bag were what? Peanut butter and tuna. How do you explain that? It's not as if we had sent out a message, oh, we need peanut butter and tuna, out into the, we need peanut butter and tuna. We didn't freak out, we need peanut butter and tuna. We believed that the peanut butter and tuna would be provided. And not only was it was provided within minutes of the need. So that when somebody else came in and said, do y'all have any peanut butter today? Oh yeah, we got peanut butter. And this peanut butter has been sent by God. Now they thought we had lost our minds, but we didn't. Because we knew where that peanut butter had come from. There are other things that are happening within this ministry. Every week, I am receiving at least 2 or 3 emails from people who are just discovering the beauty of this ministry. This past week, one that touched my heart was from a teenager who said, I am watching your broadcast, your church service, in the privacy of my own room, because I'm afraid to come out to my parents. They make me go to a church where I hear things like, love the sinner, but hate the sin. And every time I go to that church, I walk out feeling worse than when I went in. But I get to watch your church service and hear that God loves LGBTQIA+ people. And it's the consistency of the message that blesses this young person. And I'm stopped in my tracks. And I'm so grateful that in my disbelief that we needed a virtual service, that God sent Catherine, that God sent Heather, and insisted that we begin broadcasting our service. And this is what they said. The world deserves to hear our message. The word deserves, the world deserves to hear our understanding of who God is and who God wants to be in our lives. And in that, in this young person knowing that they have been fed lies, they see the miracle happen again. That God loves them, that God cares for them just the way they are. Every single time we stand up and speak up for the oppressed, for those people who are marginalized, for those people who are lied to, for those people who are hungry, every time we work to dismantle systems of marginalization and oppression by standing up for those children that have been taken from their parents by U.S. immigration, every time that we work to bring those children back together with their parents, the miracle of God's compassion and God's love is realized. Every time we stand up for people being bullied or told that they are not worth loving, the miracle happens yet again. Every time that we reach out to anybody who is depressed, anybody going through difficulty, anyone believing that they need someone else so that they can thrive in this world, any time that we help them realize that what they need is a relationship with God who will transform their life, the miracle continues. And so my question is, we, Jesus' disciples, in this day and age, how do we need to continue to let the miracle of God's transforming love transform how we see ourselves and how we see others, especially with the realities of COVID-19? How will we present what we have to be used by God, knowing that we will always have enough and that God will always bless our efforts? What will we do to continue to allow this ministry to thrive? We have been so blessed during this time of our world where we're going through so much. And at every opportunity we see something or someone coming at us, beating us up, we get to claim that God is not done with MCC Richmond yet. That God has much for us to do in this world. And we are motivated by that. Why? Because we believe in the miracles of the feeding of the 5,000. We believe that Jesus will meet our needs. We believe that God cares about us. As Philip and I were sharing this morning, we believe that God is bringing us to a new kind of ministry, that we are learning how to be the church differently. I am so grateful that Troy Perry started UFMCC, but I am so grateful that our mission has changed and has expanded to be what it is today. Will you join me in realizing that God wants to use us to bless the world as we present ourselves to be used? I don't know about you, but I get really excited about that. That God will use me in my disbelief to bring blessings, because it's not what I do, it's why I do them. That's important. So join me in believing that God wants to bless us just the way we are, and that we will be blown away by experiencing and being transformed by God's amazing love for us. Amen? Amen. Thank you.
Before we pass around the virtual offering plate, I want to invite one of those crazy characters from our fundraising team, who I get to work with because they are crazy and they make fun out of fundraising. Jenny, on behalf of Miss Ricky and the team, has a message to share.
I know, uh-oh is right. Okay, actually I had another message first. That last song was thanks to Jay Irvine, so continue to send in your songs. T and I are working that one out, but it's all good. Okay, okay. So as Sean said, I'm here in Miss Ricky's stead, which is not ever an easy thing, so let me just say that up front. She did call me last night to make sure that I said what she wanted me to say, so that was also covered. So I hope sometime this week you received this lovely letter. It looks like this, that Sean put out. I know it's blasted on the website, on our Facebook maybe. It's all over the place. If you haven't gotten one, I'm sure if you call Sean, he's got one of these because he gave me this one this morning because I forgot mine. So just to kind of sum up what we're thinking about, the fundraising team, unable to do all those really cool things we did last year, like wear a different kind of a mask, and drink some wine maybe and do some dancing, all those things. We can't get together and do that this year. So we've kind of think some things through and figure out a way that we can make some funds for our church, maybe not the $20,000 we raised last year, but hopefully $5,000. So our challenge is we would like to have 50 people give $100. That's the hope. Now if you feel like that's just impossible for you, don't let that hold you back. We will take a dollar, we'll take $5, we'll take whatever you would like. If you want to give the whole $5,000, you can do that as well.
Yeah.
So however you're feeling led to contribute to this fundraiser, we would be more than happy. Make sure if you send some money into Sean, you note that it's for the fundraiser. And if you have someone you want to remember, do that as well. I heard from Kenny this morning, just this week already, we've raised $1,300. So woohoo! We're looking forward to the rest of it rolling in here the rest of this week, and we have until September the 1st to make this a non-event or unevent, I think Kenny called it a no-event fundraiser, to be a success by September 1st. So thank you.
Thank you, Jenny, and the fundraising team. With that said, now I pass around and open our virtual basket. You can go to mccrichmond.org/giving and see all the different ways that you can share and offer and give to this wonderful ministry that continues beyond today. If you find that you're having difficulties navigating the website or how to mark where you would like your money to go, whether it be the fundraiser that we have or any other offering, I invite you and encourage you, please do not hesitate to contact me at the church office, either through email, telephone call. You can send messages on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. There are many different ways, but please do not find any discouragement in how you can give to MCC Richmond. Thank you.
You know, this is not rehearsed. But you know, we're family. And we can do, because you know families, we don't rehearse. I was so moved by, I got a call from Miss Ricky last night, and I'm going to be one of those 50 people. But I want to put it out there to the family that this church does so much for our community. A lot of churches, because of COVID, have shut down their different ministries. But it seems like here, our ministries have ballooned. And that pastor has not allowed the circumstances to dictate his virtues. And I love him for that. So I'm going to be the first in the sanctuary to do my donation. We continue to feed. We continue to help those who are shut in. We continue to be the church that God has called us for. So as Miss Jenny said, whatever amount that you can give would be appreciative. But that 100, boys, I mean, like, you know, that's good. And if we trust Spirit, we'll do that. And I would like to see us go beyond the 5,000. All things are possible because we believe, we are believing church. So I'm dedicating my first 100 today for this ministry to continue on because we are touching lives outside of these four walls. And I just love it. And I want to thank you for allowing me just to jump in. Go ahead, Miss Jenny, do your thing.
Oh, all right. So yeah, definitely not rehearsed, and thank you, Georgia. And thanks to all those others who have already donated, and we're just looking forward to all the wonderful things that are still ahead. So this next song we can thank Kendall McKnight for, so let's count our blessings. No. That was close, but not quite. Count your blessings, name them. I know he hasn't. We sang it this morning, so I know it's over there. Count your many blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God has done. Count your blessings, name them one by one.
As we come to the sacred, to the holy meal, the center of our worship, let us remember that Jesus is the host of this meal and that Jesus turns no one away. Come now, just as you are, and experience this sacred time with God. Let us observe a moment of reflection as we silently confess our concerns and shortcomings to God. Let us say together, loving and gracious God, forgive those things we have done and left undone that have caused pain to you, others, and ourselves. Help us to learn from these things and remind us of your forgiving presence and transforming love. Blessed of God, through the life and ministry of Jesus, God forgives us. God heals us and showers us with gifts of love, hope, and grace just the way we are, and welcomes us to this feast of victory and life. In the many names of our Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer, we embrace all that is holy as we say together, Holy One, God of power and might, you fill the earth with your glory, love, and grace. Blessed is the one who brings hope and welcome to all. All praise, glory, and honor to you, our God. Through your divine spirit of love and hope, we know you in our everyday experiences and are transformed by love. By the power of this divine spirit, faith is born. From the divine one, we have many names and languages for faith, gifts of the divine spirit. We remember how Jesus' promise to his disciples long ago and to us that he will always be with us. We remember how on the night before his betrayal and arrest, Jesus took bread. He gave thanks for the bread and then broke it and gave it to his disciples saying, Take, eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. We remember how after supper, Jesus took the cup, and when he had given thanks for the cup, he gave it to them saying, Drink this, all of you. This is my love poured out for you and for everyone. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me. By the power and grace of the divine spirit, may this bread and cup be the body and love of Jesus for us and Jesus with us. In preparation for sharing this meal and mystery, let us say together the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. These gifts of bread and love, gifts of God for the people of God, the beloved of God, be what you see, receive who you are. Let us partake. Let us pray together. Holy One, we give you thanks that we have been fed from this spiritual table. Continue to remind us that you care for us, that you provide for us, that you use us to be a blessing to others. Help us claim your abundance. Help us live not with scarcity, but the reminder of the abundance that your love transforms us and uses us in ways we have not even yet imagined. We give you thanks for your love and your grace. We pray this in all of your many names and in everything that is holy, we say together, Amen, 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 and so it is.
Thanks to everyone for worshiping with MCC Richmond Spiritual Community this week. Remember, like, share, follow, subscribe, and most definitely comment on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and now YouTube. If this is your first time, or maybe second or third time, joining MCC Richmond Spiritual Community in this broadcast, I invite you and encourage you to send a message through Facebook Live or on YouTube, or to the church office at our website, and letting me know that this is your first, second, or third time. We'd like to just chat with you and help you in any way that we can, myself or Pastor Kenny or anyone else at MCC Richmond. Remember to email Pastor Kenny at godguykenny@gmail.com with where you watched this video, whether it's today or later in the week. Our virtual activity for this week is still Select a Song in Summer, so continue to send your favorite songs, hymn, worship music into the church office or through the link in the e-blast. There's also a place where you can do it on the website, and I will share that in just a moment. And this week, added to that, Pastor Kenny had asked you to write a parable of the kingdom of heaven through your eyes, and he received over 24 responses. That's great. That's exciting. So now I challenge even more people this week, if you're up to it, write and share with Pastor Kenny how you have experienced a miracle in your life or how God has used you to bring a miracle to someone else. While our miracles may not be feeding 5,000 with 5 loaves of bread and a few fish, we all have miracles that we can share. So please send those in to Pastor Kenny. And then one of the more important things is tomorrow at 10 a.m., we open the registration for a limited number of people, that is 12 people, that will begin being able to join this worship service every Sunday. Again, that begins at 10 a.m. tomorrow. Now, there will be several ways that you can register your attendance, and if the spots fill up, we have a wait list that we'll work through and on that. So first, there will be a web place on our website where there will be a link. It is mccrichmond.org/COVID-19. This link will take you to the event registration place. Tomorrow at 10 a.m., this link will be live, so don't try it beforehand. You may see it there later today or early tomorrow morning. It's not going to work. But it will work at 10 a.m. tomorrow, along with an e-blast will be sent out from the church office with that same link. If you are unable or have difficulty using the link on the website or that same link in the e-blast, please contact the church office. I will be there right at 10 a.m. ready to answer the phone. If you get the voicemail, please leave your name and what it's about. Those voicemails are time-stamped. We know that many people have expressed their interest in wanting to join and come home to MCC Richmond from their home, and we want everyone to have that opportunity. So do not feel discouraged, even though there's only limited 12 spaces, we'll get through it as we do. So with that, I think that's enough announcements. Again, remember, this is the end of worship service today, but as Georgia said earlier, it's not the end of the ministry here at MCC Richmond. So please continue.
All will be well, and all will be well, and all manner of things will be well, all will be well, be well.